صراحة شكلي مواطن في أبناء هذه، تخيلوا بريطانيا، we have something but okay being paralyzed at the different needs first emphasized to the what state of this now, the genocide that is taking place in Russia is process of values or revealing values at the level of the world. You have to show the levels of one of interest, the value varies, an exposure of the international value. The standard that we lived for a long time and that have been tested and examined in this particular the presence of another war that Ukraine and also the exposure of interest. We hear mainly about the world, the South, that realized that the relationship with the world needs corrected also the interest and to prove restoring or redefining the order that we understand. In my intervention, I would be addressing how the region, I mean the Arab world, and the surrounding area, how do they understand the genocide in the which is that everybody has no citizens understand why the Arabs. How could all that happen without any action taken by the Arabs in any direction to stop this? I try to answer this. How can the region understand this? How the region can understand this genocide in Gaza and how they deal with it on this basis. At first, I would like to emphasize, based on my understanding, there are Arab sentiments that are Arab sentiments, but there are no Arab position, no one Arab position. It's absent. However, the sentiments do exist. In other words, the sentiments are not being translated at the level of action. And I would go into explaining the position rather than the sentiments, given that the sentiments of pain that are common in the Arab world from the ocean to the Gulf. However, what did happen to the position or the stance to take action regarding the genocide, and why aren't there any active position? When I speak about a position, I would be differentiating between two levels. The first one is the official position and the other is the masses or the popular position, and these are two different positions when we speak about the Arab position. Regarding the Arab position, the official Arab position, I mean, there are three aspects or three dynamics that control this position that we see since that we have seen being noticing since the genocide started. The first factor that controls the Arab bloc, which I call working based on what this bloc sees, which is the regional balance. So dealing genocide in Gaza is committed by one side that is joined by a number of Arab states who see the conflict as a regional balance, or searching rather for a
a regional balance, and that this conflict is an equation, an regional equation, and that this is the Iran conflict, or what they call the axis of resistance. So this classification is based on the regional equation that controls a number of states. And under this camp comes Saudi Arabia, the Emirates, Bahrain, on one hand, and on the other, we have those who look at this war as the axis of resistance for states such as Yemen, Lebanon, Syria, Iraq. So this classification is based on a regional equation, and at the end of the day, for such states, it's not Gaza or the citizen or the genocide. It is an attempt. It's the attempt by these states searching for supremacy, regional supremacy with a new regional equation. And eventually, and given all these details, you would look at the victims or the genocide in Gaza as a victim, as a victim resulting from the regional balance of the occupier and trying to look for a more balanced regional equation. So since this is the position, the breaking of this resistance axis is translated into the interest of the states on the other party or on the other side who are looking for a regional balance with Iran in the area. So it's not a matter of Palestine, but Palestine is the victim. According to this system, the other equation that controls the official stance, there is another block that is based on not the original equation, but rather the relationship between the alliances and supporting the allies. And the allies, of course, here are the Islamic Hamas movement that is originates from the Muslim Brothers, the resistance and the Islamic tendency of this battle that is being led by Hamas and other factions, in addition to the Palestinian people. So this bloc, represented by Turkey, Qatar, who have long relationships with Hamas movement and with other Islamic, different Islamic movements. This position is to support diplomatically or to provide limited diplomatic support. Diplomatic support cannot or does not or do not get translated financially, but rather a movement or military action that is able to affect the war or to affect the military balances that control this war, where there is sufficiency in terms of diplomatic support at this level as a result of the support of the allies and the relationship with the allies. The third group or the third bloc, who is based on another mechanism, which is linked to the national priorities for such states. Let me not differentiate a lot between the national priorities and the priorities of the regimes. Regarding the regimes, they are national priorities, but in many cases, they are also the priorities of the regime. This is another discussion that maybe needs another session. What's the difference between the priorities of the regime as opposed to the priorities of the regarding the official position, it claims that these are national priorities, meaning that a national priority of the state is way more important than engaging in a war or in acting in connection with changing the equation or affecting the equation, because the national priority means the economic interest, the military collaboration, or focusing on development in that state is more important. So this camp or this block or this third block, it tries to isolate itself from what's occurring in the Gaza war and is based in the politics, based on the realistic the political reality, and then we have Egypt, Jordan, Morocco, Algeria involved in this direction. And even if they are confronting challenges brought by the crisis, so this is first the national priority, such as the Jordan isolates itself from the confrontation between Israel and Iran, and not use the Jordanian space, for example, for this. To involve itself in this confrontation in this or this war. And regarding Egypt, for example, the national priority is to focus on development, security in Egypt, and perhaps at the Philadelphia crossing, you can say something, but it would bring you back to the, or get you closer to the Egyptian side. But if trying to isolate yourself, except with what is being imposed by the war on the national agendas or on the regimes, the agendas of the regimes. So once again, I don't want to get into such a limited time in the relationship between the priorities of the national or political regime. So this is the third direction that controls the Arab official position. So Arab or officially speaking, there are three blocks that are controlled by various foundations of the relations or in relationship with the war or the genocide in Gaza. Now, the question is, what about the popular position? Of course, there's a difference, a clear, big difference between the official and the popular position. The popular position, as we said, in sympathizing and feeling the anger and feeling the inability to do anything or to feel sorry or to a feeling of regrets for being unable to impact or to have an impact on the genocide events in Gaza. It's a feeling or a sentiment with the Arab citizens in the Arab states. The question is, Why can't this feeling be translated into action or work? There are a number of reasons behind that. First, the Arab states or the Arab communities are still experiencing the results or the outcome of the Arab Spring, meaning that the Arab Spring, led by a number of Arab states, ended eventually, but did not, of course, end forever, but only the first wave of it, which lasted more than 10 years. This first wave or this first phase ended with the success or the winning of the supremacy of the regimes or the so-called the counter-revolutions, meaning that the Arab citizen was defeated in the Arab Spring battle, whereas the winning was for dictatorship, or the Arab dictatorship were the winners. The defeated Arab citizen in the Arab Spring, whether in Syria, Lebanon, in Syria, Egypt, Yemen, Libya, and in Tunis, this Arab citizen, all their feelings went back to their positions in terms of the relationship inside the state, went back to the oppression, to the persecution. They are defeated, they are oppressed, they are defeated. It took them back to square one before the Arab Spring in terms of persecution and oppression, and they became silent spectators who would only see and feel, but they cannot act. So this is the first cause why the feelings are not being translated, the popular feelings or sentiments are not translated into action. The second factor, which is the retract of the ideologies or the ideologies as we know during the days of Abdel Nasser or after Abdel Nasser, the national Arab feeling that used to be, that would lead to a certain position does not exist anymore. And not in the same strength or momentum. It is weakened, or we have the supremacy of the national state at the level of the nationalism, Arab nationalism. Even the Islamic position, when the Islamic movements in the Arab Spring benefited from the first stage of the Arab Spring in 2012-2014, the Enlightenment in Tunis, and the reforms in Egypt and Yemen, etc. This also decreased to a large extent. Even the Islamites, or the, there's a division in terms of their positions. We have the Islamists of Syria, of Iran, Islamists with Hamas in Palestine, and the relationship with Hezbollah and Iran. So in both parts of the equation, it's all divided. For example, the Islamists in Syria are against Iran and Hezbollah, whereas the Hamas Islamists are with Hezbollah and Iran. So this this retract, or this decrease and decline of these ideologies, they lost the opportunity of translating the sentiments or feelings into action in this respect. The third factor that still serves as and that still impedes the translation of sentiment into action is the sharp recruitment or polarization that the Arab world is experiencing. It's a severe polarization based on many factors or foundations, whether the relationship with Iran or with the Islamists, or the relationship with the Arab regimes who try to lead another tendency, which is the openness to Israel, to the states, and to the international system or regime, etc. So there is this severe or sharp polarization in the Arab region. The procedures or the what is taking place, including the genocide, is seen under certain polarization, or under this polarization standards, or in order to have it controlled by the vision and the position towards this. So the outcome was a total paralysis in terms of action, especially the financial support. There are financial support campaigns, there are demonstrations, the protests in Morocco, in Jordan, in Lebanon, in many areas. And there are also relief campaigns that includes that are merely for media, for show off. And even this humanitarian support, financial support, humanitarian financial support is usually directed towards the citizens inside the state that rather than a response to the war, to the genocide, or to the dispute in Gaza. At the level of the feeling, there is a lot of anger, a lot of frustration, disappointment at such regimes, that there is financial support provided to these states. And this is rather a way of expressing this anger. Regarding the divisions or the splits in terms of the official and popular positions, and the internal divisions inside the official and popular splits, comes the question, what's next, or what to do? How can this dealt with at a Palestinian level, so as not to leave you with only a diagnosis of the situation, adding to your frustration? I try to shed light on, or maybe highlight some points, how to deal with this position or this regional position at a Palestinian level. I don't want to reiterate what's being said in the different platforms that the Palestinian position is unified to end the split, that the split is the main cause for such Arab, the different Arab positions, and that there has to have a unified or one Palestinian position and to end the division, so that the Palestinians can be taken more seriously, and so that the division would not lead to a state of justifications for other regimes to say that the Palestinians themselves are divided and that they are responsible for what's happening to them and to the others. And it would be okay just to look at our own interests. Of course, as you all know, this is a talk. We need always to remind people about this. I think this was the main factor that harmed the Palestinian cause and the Palestinian national project. However, I want to emphasize another factor, which is also important, critical in dealing with such changes or variables, which is the absence of a Palestinian vision, the absence of a Palestinian strategy. What do we need? What do we want under this or within such genocide and such dispute or struggle that is taking place? And as I emphasize the importance of a vision that for any emancipatory movement or any liberation project. Since the Balfour Declaration until 1993, there has always been a vision. At the beginning, there was a vision of the Palestinian state over all Palestine. And in 1974, the 10 points, and then the interim program, there was a talk on the on part of Palestine program. And in 1993, there was a new vision constituted, represented by the 1967 state with the recognition of Israel, despite law, and its disastrous impact. That also accord gives or offered some vision to the Palestinian people, and this vision, regardless where you stand, it's the Palestinian state on the 1967 borders. However, this vision, despite its bad position and problems after 2012, 2013, and the arrival of Trump at the at government and the failure Obama, this vision has vanished. No Palestinian vision, no longer any Palestinian vision, whether one state or two states or multinational state or the trilateral solution. The Palestinian vision vanished and it went into a state of chaos. So the importance of the vision, I would emphasize its connection to another important factor, that is the cause or the reason why this vision is absent, is the absence of leadership to the Palestinian people. Simply speaking, my dear, there is no leadership for the Palestinian people ever since the late Arafat died. There is a leader, there is a president to the Palestinian people, but not a leader. A Palestinian leader or the Palestinian leadership was actually ended with the martyrdom of Yasser Arafat, and there has never been any Palestinian leadership ever since. There is a Palestinian presidency that only plays a functional role or institutional role or administrative role of the state and the Palestinian National Authority or the entity, the Palestinian existence, but this is completely different from the Palestinian leadership or a Palestinian leader. The leadership is the one that provides a vision that has the Palestinian people surrounding it, or maybe a semi-consensus by the Palestinian people, the relationship of confidence and trust between the people and the leader, mutual confidence and trust. The leadership would be at the in the front of the battle or trench, but the president is managing the battle from his office. A leader would be the first one in the front and the last one to withdraw. So we can speak about this maybe in another session regarding the sufferings of the Palestinian National Project with the absence of Palestinian leadership and the presence of a Palestinian presidency. This, of course, affected a vision or a national strategy, a Palestinian national strategy or vision that can deal with the Arab changes that we talked about. If you could jump to the conclusions within a couple minutes. Thank you for reminding me. Hence, I try to remind you of what my colleague, Dr. Bassem Zbedi, spoke about in a previous session, that is focusing on the international community in terms of the weakness or poorness and the Arab weak status. Of course, there are some new representatives of the Palestinian people, or maybe some the international community and not the international regimes. We mean here the involvement of the international NGOs, the students, institutions, and even the staff or staff members in international institutions. We have here the internationalization, the internationalization of the Palestinian cause. And this is a paper we talked, Dr. Bassem and I talked about prior to October 7th. We published this paper regarding the conflict facing the Palestinian cause, the conflict between the internationalization for us as Palestinians, and Israel at the time wanted to make regionalizing the regionalism as opposed to internationalism. Israel wanted to regionalize the conflict to involve the Emirates, Bahrain, Morocco, and Sudan, etc., and confining it inside the region towards internationalism or internationalization based on new values or foundations such as the values of freedom, justice, human dignity, equal rights, that serve as a substitute, as I said before, the retract of the ideologies, national ideologies. These are new international values that constitute new foundations for the Palestinian struggle. Before October 7, we published this research paper. We expected that the future struggle scene would be in the literally in the Palestinian American universities and courts. That is actually taking place right now. So I believe this necessitates a discussion or in-depth talk in dealing with this fragmentation position, the position of this kind of fragmentation and the relationship between the northern and the southern states, because there is also a wake-up call. The genocide in Gaza to the south, to the southern world, was a wake-up call, and this needs a new relationship and not as it used to look in the before. Thank you so much for taking much of your time.